We start in space in 2058. As mutant terrorists try to stop the construction of a new hypergate that can send the population of a dying Earth to a nicer planet, and she... So a hotshot fighter pilot called Major Don West, who's bizarrely played by Joey or Friends for some reason, soon fends them off, and disobeys a direct order not to go and save his damaged teammate. But decides to do it anyway, because he's a hotshot fighter pilot, bro. So proceeds to totally rescue his buddy with a ludicrous southern accent from crashing into the gate.
Don, I'm falling towards the hypergate, man.
Meanwhile, down on Earth, we meet 10-year-old tech genius Will Robinson and his generic mum, Maureen. Whilst his dad, John, explains to the media how his new hypergate thing will totally save their entire species, given it creates a wormhole between two points in space and thereby allows instantaneous travel between vast distances. And before you can say, I think Roland Emmerich's going to sue someone, his family start packing up to leave so they can totally join their dad on the trip over to the new Alpha Prime planet to construct the connecting Stargate. Hypergate. As we also meet teenage daughter Penny, who has the squeakiest voice since literally any 12-year-old gamer kid on Xbox Live back in the day, and what loves doing futuristic YouTube vlogs about how she doesn't really want to go off to a new galaxy to help her dad set up a new hospitable planet for her whole species to live on. Some sheep. Anyway, the original pilot for the trip has just been murdered off screen by them naughty space terrorists, so they've roped in Joey or Friends as a backup, despite him just being bollocked for disobeying a direct order to not go and help his dying mate with a ludicrous accent.
Am I good or what?
And the man who just said he wants someone good and stable to ensure his family's safety just laughs and shrugs after hearing how reckless and insubordinate this guy is, and then literally says, yeah, he'll do. Elsewhere, the Robinson's family doctor called Smith turns out to be a spy for the naughty terrorist group, who have now ordered him to go sabotage their trip out to the cosmos to build the second hypergate in G. Whilst back on the main ship called Jupiter 2, horny Major Don meets top-totty engineer Judy, and he immediately hits on her, before accidentally telling her own dad how she gives him a right raging lob on. Hello, oaks. Later, said John Fella again just shrugs when he's shown his son's science fair project, which is essentially a prototype time machine model, whilst naughty spy Dr. Smith totally does some naughty terrorism by reprogramming the ship's security robot to destroy the Robinson family once they get a few hours into the journey. But before he can leave, he soon gets double-crossed and then knocked out in the ship's access tunnels like a right Wally. Also later, the family are promptly stuffed into cryosleep pods and then sent off on their way, as the dopey Dr. Smith soon wakes up and almost gets killed by his own robot where he just reprogrammed to shoot up the gaff. So naturally, he revives the fam to totally help him out already. But unfortunately, they're fucking useless, and all end up having to be saved by a 10-year-old scrope with a basic Lenovo tablet.
Oh!
After things calm down a bit, Major Don threatens to kill that naughty terrorist what just woke him out of a deep sleep and saucy dreams about that greasy engineer what happens to be his boss's daughter kid, but then promises to spare his life if the doc can save said top-totty Judy from being trapped in a small pod. But to be fair, poor Joey or Friends has got bigger problems to deal with, given the ship is now hurtling into the sun and she. So, in an act of desperation, the reckless fighter pilot decides to activate the hyperdrive, despite it not being tethered to a hypergate, and which will certainly end up just spitting them out anywhere in deep space.
What?
And although Dr. John don't really fancy being lost in space, he also don't really have much of a choice, given they're currently crashing into a fucking sun without even factor 50 sun cream. So they promptly engage said hyperdrive, which also makes them float about in awkward CG slow-mo because reasons, before flying straight through the star and promptly spitting them out into another solar system. Luckily, Judy is A-OK, so they indeed spare the life of that naughty spy fella as long as he promises never to do any of them bad things ever again. But unfortunately, they're now lost in the cosmos, and soon come across a weird and potentially dangerous distortion in space. So naturally, the reckless fighter pilot, who they happily made a space captain earlier, now recklessly enters a dodgy hole in space despite having kids on board because reasons. And then discover an abandoned human-looking ship called the Proteus. So, in order to progress the plot, they decide to board said Proteus ship, whilst Tech Whiz Wheel has reprogrammed the crazy killer robot so it can totally protect them instead of shooting them up worse than an icy-cold soulless automaton taking out his own high school. And as they get deeper in, They come across some weird biological fluid dripping on the floor from some sort of egg sac on the ceiling. And before I can say, it's a limewell. Dr. Smith ominously echoes my own blatantly obvious sentiments and says nothing good will come from this. And they then find an upgraded version of that killer robot thing, implying this ship is a futuristic version of their own Jupiter-class ship. And once activating the captain's log, Major Don just can't believe that his best mate with a ludicrous southern accent has been made captain of his own ship, and somehow come out on a rescue mission to find them before they even got lost. But before they can try to figure out how the heck Earth was able to launch a rescue mission, given they've barely been lost a day, they find a real-life Pokemon fella just hanging out in a bush. So naturally, they name it Blarp and decide to totally keep the strange alien creature with four nostrils because reasons. Later, the crew download the ship's star maps to Alpha Prime, when suddenly, the egg sacs totally hatch, and the crew soon find themselves under attack by piss-poorly rendered CGI spiders.
Oh shit, not good.
So, this newly reformed robot fella what now loves shouting Danger Will Robinson at the top of his lungs, blasts through the door so they can get the heck out of Dodge already. But it soon gets overwhelmed, and it looks like it's curtains for the bipolar robot what loves shooting up kids one moment and then totally taking orders from them the next.
Okay.
Whilst that naughty Dr. Spy bloke gets scratched up by them spider things on the way out. And once back on the Jupiter ship, they wonder if they can somehow wound the creatures to get them to eat each other, given that's apparently what arachnids do. But turns out their torpedoes are as much use as a chocolate teapot. So they instead distract the CG spiders by remotely igniting the Proteus' main engines and then totally overloading them. Because as we all know, if you ever see just one spider lurking around, you've got to kill it with fire and then burn your whole house down just to be sure. So when you see a whole armada of killer alien spiders, you've totally got to detonate a ship's entire nuclear drive to make sure you get every last single one of the fuckers. Unfortunately, Dr. John specifically told Major Don not to detonate the ship's fusion drive given how close they were to the blast radius, and that was super dangerous, bro, given my entire family were on board and shit. And he just can't believe that the reckless insubordinate fighter pilot, what he initially laughed off and shrugged at when they first met, would violate his direct order. Anyway, after the Jupiter crashes into a nearby planet, they take a quick moment to study the alien Pokemon thing with the four fucking nostrils. And Judy says that a teenage sis can totally keep the extraterrestrial monkey fella, what represents humanity's first contact with alien life, as a little pet. Even though it could have space rabies or even an undiscovered appetite for human flesh and shit. But Penny don't really care, given how she can totally use it in her vlogs to get a few more likes and subs. And to be fair, it sure ain't the first time a YouTuber has used a brainless monkey to generate a few more clicks and controversy.
Oh, there he is! Oh no, Sam Cedar, what a fucking nightmare!
Thank you, Steven.
I had no idea this was going to happen. I thought Ethan was a stand-up guy. I said, I guarantee you, he's going to do anything he can to avoid the debate.
Fuck you!
Meanwhile, Dr. Smith is struggling with his itchy spider bite, though this time doesn't say anything about this probably not going to be ending well. Whilst elsewhere, Major Don tries to stick it on his boss's eldest daughter. And before he can say,
how you doing?
He probably gets doused with a glass of water for his troubles. Because apparently, she don't want to shag the only bloke in the galaxy what ain't related to her, nor has a smelly septic spider bite in his back. Anyway, the next morning, they find another one of them bubble distortions outside on the planet, and soon reckon they're totally time portals, which would explain how Earth were able to realise that they were missing so quickly, and send a black guy with a ludicrous accent after them, despite them not even being gone for 24 hours. And after the 10-year-old boy Wonder posits that going inside them might take them further into the future and that this might not be a particularly natural phenomena, his dismissive daddy just tells him that he's watched too much InfoWars and that he should just stop being a total conspiracy theorist and shut up about it already. Naturally, poor Will Robinson is pretty butthurt about never being listened to, despite being so smart he built a prototype time machine model for his science fair project last week, whilst his dad goes on to explain how these time bubbles are totally destabilising the planet and stuff, so they don't have much time to fuck around. Anyway, after apologising to Judy for being a misogynist space pig and not being able to keep it in his pants for 5 minutes despite being lost in deep space, Major Don and Dr. John head on out to investigate the time portal, whilst young Will goes ahead and builds another robot and uses friggin' CD drives to somehow download his own mind into the new machine.
Okay.
Meanwhile, Major Don and his buddy John soon get shot up by a familiar-looking robot, what young Will has literally just built in his lap. Whilst Dr. Smith then manipulates said young Will kid into going down to the planet to make sure his dad is A-OK, given there's earthquakes going on and fucking time portals popping up all over the gaff. And shockingly, Dr. Smith soon finds some gravestones of the entire Robinson family. Well, the girls at least. And also shockingly, the captured lads soon find out that their naughty kidnapper is none other than a totally older version of young Will, who says that in his timeline, some of them weird CG spider things totally survived the giant fuck-off nuclear explosion and came down to the planet before then munching up his mum and sisters. So naturally, he built a proper time machine so he could go back and stop them all leaving Earth in the first place, didn't she? Unfortunately, though, there's only enough power to send one lucky fucker back through the doorway. And before they can say, why don't we just hook up the power cores from our Jupiter so we can boost the portal and have it send us all home already, Dr. Smith bursts in and holds young Will hostage. Because he wants to be the one to go through that dodgy space hole and then fuck off home already. But suddenly, a giant hooded freak appears. No, not Senator John Fetterman. And turns out the future version of Dr. Smith has totally mutated from his earlier spider bite into some sort of Emperor Palpatine fella. And so promptly throws his younger self over a ledge and tells the robot to take the prisoners away already. But luckily, young Will overrides a cold and emotionless future robot by appealing to his own emotion deep inside, given he initially programmed in with his own mind via CD-ROM about an hour ago. Whilst Dr. John tells the Major to get back to the ship and fly his family the heck out of Dodge already. Because he's going to do one of them self-sacrifice things, given he can't fly the ship as well as him, and also because he's now become his friend. Whilst up at the portal, the evil Emperor Palpatine cosplayer promptly disrobes after the older yet still genius Will starts to put two and two together. Because in a shocking twist, what no one could ever see coming, turns out the mutant monster bloke, what now looks like a fucking spider demon, was the one what killed his original family all along, and has just been using him for the past 2 decades to build the time machine thing.
No way!
So, said genius yet dopey fella totally reduces the size of the portal, so that the surrounding plasma will kill the dastardly fiend if he tries to go through it, given his massive size. Which naturally pisses off the giant monstrosity royally. Because turns out the fat, shaming, hooded mutant freaks what killed his own family ain't actually a good idea, son. So Spider Smith throws his only friend of 20 years down into the hole, whilst the creature with the worst CG since the fucking Scorpion King has a final face-off with Daddy Robinson. And after remembering how spiders apparently eat their wounded, he proceeds to wound his spindly foe a few times and then ruptures his egg sac, leading to his own babies indeed munching him up real good and proper. Where John fatally knocks him down into the plasma and then totally rescues his phony fakey older son who somehow didn't get deadied earlier. And despite Don and younger Will making it back to the ship, they can't get up into orbit in time and are quickly blown to Kingdom Come. So older Will reconfigures the time coordinates to a few minutes earlier and totally sends his daddy back through the portal now he understands how much he loved him after all. But alas, there was only enough power for one trip. So he tells his younger self to take care of his family. And said young Will fella says, yeah, I totally will, bro. And he just can't believe he's going to end up looking like a space hobo who can't afford a haircut despite clearly having a well-groomed beard because reasons. And after the portal closes, they decide to go down through the planet this time instead of trying to fly above it and failing miserably. And Major West then completes his character arc by finally following a direct order for once in his fucking life. Before they eventually make it through the collapsing planet. And having saved all their lives, local misogynist Major West earns a sloppy slobbery snog from hot totty Judy and right in front of her dad and entire family.
Nice.
And we end with the crew now activating the hyperdrive again, but this time with the star maps what they got from the abandoned Proteus ship earlier on, and soon blast off into deep space, whilst the schizo end credits promptly send me into a pretty serious epileptic fit. And that's it. That's the movie. Though, my favourite part was realising just how superfluous most of these characters really were. I mean, what did Judy, Penny, Maureen, or even that horrific CGI monkey fella even do in this film? They were all more pointless than the tampon machine in the men's box, son. And speaking of baffling things, why on earth was this called Lost in Space when it was really more about being lost in time? Oh, I don't know. The script has lines like,
"Give my regards to Oblivion."
So, screw thinking and shit. But anyway, that's a blot and that's a lot. Considering that moving, so you don't miss any future recaps. Tell me if you like this flick in the comments if you have time. And I'll see you in the next one.